بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. مساء الخير. Good evening everybody. It's my pleasure today we have the journal club under the Saudi Society of Clinical Chemistry collaborated with the King Saud University and King Saud University Medical City. This activity as usual supported by Saudi Society of Clinical Chemistry as usual. We're looking forward to continue this activity as usual. Today this activity accredited by 2SME by Saudi Commission for Health Specialties. My name is Dr. Khalid Samali, Consultant of Medical Biochemistry. I will moderate this meeting with our resident in King Saud University Fellowship of Clinical Pathology. Today we will talk about the journal club in King Saud University regarding the lipid management for the prevention of atherosclerosis cardiovascular disease, which has been published in the New England Journal of Medicine 2019. Why we select this paper? Actually, as you know, in the United States and the most of the developed countries, cardiovascular disease, which is include coronary artery disease, stroke, peripheral artery disease, it still remain the leading cause of death in the men and women equally. Furthermore, the cardiovascular disease is becoming the leading cause of the death worldwide. Today, it's my pleasure to introduce first speaker regarding this article, Dr. Shara Al-Ahmari. Dr. Shara Al-Ahmari, he gets his Bachelor of Medical Science from the Australia, and after that he gets the Master of Public Health from the University of Sydney and continue his medical degree in King Saud, King Saud bin Abdul Aziz University for Health Science in Riyadh, and get his MBBS degree. And after that he joined us as medical resident for the clinical pathology program. He is now is R2. Welcome, Dr. Shar, to give us this talk about your articles.
Thank you very much, Dr. Khalid. Thank you for everybody. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm Shar Al-Ahmari, your colleague from King Saud University, R2 clinical pathology resident. I'm happy today to talk about our journal club today. It's going to be about the lipid management in atherosclerotic patient. This is the article. It's lipid management for the prevention of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, which is published in New England Journal of Medicine. The following points will be discussed. The aim of choosing this article, basics educations for residents, lab technicians, and general audience about overview of lipid. As well, I will talk about common disorder of lipids, the relationship of lipids and the risk of atherosclerosis and lipid management in primary prevention and secondary prevention. Also, we'll discuss overview of lipid lowering drugs, as well as the limitation of the article on inclusion. As well, my colleague Dr. Waleed Sinani will discuss the case of the study. Aim of choosing this article, management of serum cholesterol is important for the cardiovascular event. Also, developing new management of cholesterol for primary and secondary prevention to reduce risk of CVD among dyslipidemia patients, with promising new treatments that are still need further trials. First of all, I would like to give you some overview of the lipids and some definitions. We will start with the fatty acid. As you can see, fatty acid is a linear chain of carbohydrates bound ending at carboxyl group COOH, triglycerides and fat. It consists of three fatty acid molecules bounded to a glycerol. Also, as you can see in cholesterol, it's about steroid alcohol with four rings. Cholesterol ester, it's about cholesterol bounded to a fatty acid molecule. Also, I would like to discuss further the phospholipid, which is same as triglyceride, except that it has two fatty acid and one phospholipid head group. I would like to give as well overview about the lipoproteins. Usually lipoproteins, it's particles that carry and transport lipids to and from the cell. We have as well VLDL, which is very low density lipoproteins, that is carry triglyceride fats from liver to cells for energy needs and storage. LDL, low density lipoproteins, this deliver cholesterol to the cells after triglycerides, as well the HDL, which is high density lipoprotein, that is take up cholesterol from cells to liver, or which is called, means that clean up the cholesterol. Now I'll talk about the common disorders of lipids. In blood, lipoproteins transport usually cholesterol, ester, and triglycerides. So lipid disorders are due to malfunctions in either in synthesis, transport, and catabolism of lipoproteins. All of these abnormalities are collectively called dyslipidemia. Dyslipidemia divided into two types. We have hyperlipoproteinemia, which is elevated lipoprotein levels, and we have hypolipoproteinemia, which is decreased lipoprotein levels. Hyperlipoproteinemia, it's divided into three types, either hypercholesterolemia or hypertriglyceridemia, or combined hyperlipidemia, which is cholesterol and triglyceride together. Hypercholesterolemia, such as familial hypercholesterolemia, FH, this is due to elevated LDL cholesterol levels. It is a genetic disorder with a high risk for heart disease. Heterozygotes are more common than homozygotes. Patients have normal LDL synthesis, but they are deficient in LDL receptors due to defective LDL receptor gene. Also, hypercholesterolemia is LDL cholesterol builds up in the blood because of two reasons. Either no receptors to bend to LDL or no transfer of LDL to cells. This causes cholesterol deficiency in cells. The cells synthesize cholesterol at high rates to compensate the deficiency. Therefore, statins are used to reduce the cholesterol levels in heterozygous patients by either inhibition of cholesterol synthesis or stimulation of LDL receptors. In homozygous patients, statin therapy is not useful. They have no functional LDL receptors. Usually they undergo periodic LDL phases, which is cholesterol dialysis. Cholesterol levels usually in homozygotes between 800 and 1,000 milligram per deciliter, which is 20 to 26 millimole per liter. In heterozygous patient, from 300 to 600 milligram per deciliter, which is 8 to 15 millimole per liter. The relationship between the lipids and the risk of atherosclerosis, as you can see in the figure, you have the narrowing of the arteries, which is called the atherosclerosis. Usually lipid abnormalities result in deposition of the esterified cholesterol in artery walls, which start in the thin layer first, which is called fatty streaks. Then fatty streaks develop into plaques that occlude the blood flow. Plaques usually develop in the arteries of the heart. They call it coronary artery disease or CAD. This is the steps or sequence of events from the atherosclerosis leading to myocardial fracture and heart failure. It starts with sclerotic plaque and plaque rupture to thrombosis. Thrombosis causes tissue ischemia, and tissue ischemia develop to be tissue necrosis and develop to be myocardial dysfunction and finally cause the heart failure. Lipid management and primary prevention. First of all, I would like to mention that according to American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association in 2018, we have five key points from the guideline. That started from the promote a healthy lifestyle, shared decision-making with patient, determine candidate for pharmacotherapy, adopt a personalized approach, and monitor response to treatment and lifestyle. Regarding the promote a healthy lifestyle, usually they appropriate for all patients as a part of the management of the cardiovascular disease. It includes physical activity and healthy diet. While the shared decision making with the patient is very important, because it should be shared between the clinician and the patient, that is including the interpretation of the patient over 10-year risk of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. Regarding the pharmacotherapy, usually statins remains the first line agent, but for patients with clinical atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease at very high risk for a patient with severe elevated LDL cholesterol levels, non-statin agent we consider, or we need to consider, such as ezetimibe and PCSK9, and we'll discuss them further in this presentation, inshallah. A recommendation for statin therapy also include patient 40 to 75 years of age with a level of LDL cholesterol that is higher than 69 milligram per deciliter, who have diabetes or who have a 10-year risk of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease equal to greater than 7.5%. Additional consideration should be made for younger and older adults as well, and we'll discuss it in this presentation, inshallah. After calculation for the patient 10 years risk of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease risk assessment can be individualized by considering any risk enhancing factor and the patient coronary artery calcium score. If measured, the patient therapeutic response should continue to be monitored over time. So for primary prevention, usually, as we mentioned, in severe primary hypercholesterolemia, and LDL cholesterol levels, if it's more than or equal 190 milligram per deciliter, the likelihood of familial hypercholesterolemia is increased, and there is no need to calculate the 10-year risk of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. Treatment should be with high-intensity statin to mitigate the substantial lifetime risk of disease. As we can see as well, if the LDL cholesterol level remains 100 milligram per deciliter or higher, more than or equal 2.6 millimole per liter, it is reasonable to consider treatment with ezetimibe and proprotein convertase subtilidase kixin type 9, which is abbreviated by PCSK9 inhibitor, or both. Also, in patients with diabetes who are between 40 and 75 years of age, and have LDL cholesterol level of 70 milligram per deciliter or higher, there is also no need to calculate 10-year risk of cardiovascular disease. Regarding the moderate intensity statin, should be as well recommended for patients with diabetes who are at higher risk for atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, owing to multiple risk factors. Also, it's reasonable to prescribe a high intensity statin to reduce the LDL cholesterol level by 50% or more. Also, as you can see, this is the most important diagram published by American College of Cardiology and American Heart Association. Let's move now to the lipid management and secondary prevention. Regarding secondary prevention in hypercholesterolemia for patients 75 years of age or younger who have clinical atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, the LDL cholesterol level should be reduced by at least 50% with the use of high-intensity statin or the maximum tolerated dose. If the LDL cholesterol level remains at 70 milligram per deciliter or higher, with the maximum tolerated dose of statin therapy, it may be reasonable to add ezetimibe. Also, among the patients at very high risk, such as those who have had recent onset of an acute coronary syndrome, multiple events related to the atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, or a prior cardiovascular event with multiple risk factors, and those with an LDL cholesterol level, if it's more than or equal to 70 milligram per deciliter, despite receiving the maximum tolerated dose of statins, the addition of azetamib is reasonable if the LDL cholesterol it's reasonable to be added to the statin, but if the LDL cholesterol level is still 70 milligram per deciliter or higher, a PCSK9 inhibitor can be added as well. Regarding the patient who's age 75 years old or older, initiation or continuation of a moderate or high intensity statin is reasonable. The statin dose may need to be reduced in patients at risk for adverse effects for polypharmacy and altered pharmacokinetics. Let's now to talk about overview of lipid-lowering drugs. Let's start with the statins. As I mentioned before, statins remain the primary pharmacotherapy used to lower LDL cholesterol levels. Meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials have reported that for every reduction of 39 milligram per deciliter, which is 1 millimole per liter in LDL cholesterol level, statins confer relative reductions in cardiovascular events and all-cause mortality of 22% and 10% respectively. More intensive statin regimes in cardiovascular disease conferred a reduction in major adverse among those patients. That was 15% greater than that conferred with the less intensive regimes. Regarding the risk of using statins, for the vast majority of patients in whom statins are indicated, the benefit always outweighs the risks, but rarely causes muscle pain, liver damage, and neurological side effects for some patients. Let's talk now about azetamib. Azetamib among the patients with acute coronary syndrome whose LDL cholesterol levels were less than 125 milligram per deciliter, 3.2 millimole per liter, the addition of azetamib to simvastatin conferred with a significant reduction in the absolute risk of recurrent cardiovascular event of 2 percentage point. That is constituting of 6% reduction in relative risk. Also, the median LDL cholesterol level achieved was 54 milligram per deciliter, which is 1.4 millimole per liter in the group receiving simvastatin and azetamib, as compared with 70 milligram per deciliter with simvastatin alone, providing evidence of additional benefit. Benefit with the further lowering of LDL cholesterol level. So when is it used? Usually, we used azetamib in patients who have unacceptable side effects with the statins, who have severe primary hypercholesterolemia, or who have insufficient reduction in LDL cholesterol levels when taking the maximum tolerated statin dose. Regarding the PCSK9 inhibitors, gain of functional mutations in PCSK9 are a cause of familial hypercholesterolemia. PCSK9 inhibitors are used for a high-risk patient for secondary prevention or severe primary hypercholesterolemia who have adverse reactions to statin or who have an insufficient reduction in LDL cholesterol level while taking the maximum tolerated dose of statin plus azetamib. The negative thing, or the disadvantage thing of this medication, it's high cost. It's cost about $5,500 annually. Regarding the N3 fatty acid structure, usually N3 fatty acids, it's about, it's consisting of long chain of N3 polyunsaturated fatty acids, which can be mixtures of eco spontaneous acid, EPA, and deco cyhexaonic acid, which is EPA with the DHA that alone reduce triglyceride levels by reducing production of very low density lipoprotein, cholesterol, in the liver, and to a lesser extent by increasing the VLDL cholesterol clearance from the circulation. regarding the patient with severe hyper triglyceridemia. Triglyceride levels, it's more than 500 milligram per deciliter, which is 5.6 millimole per liter, typically need to be treated with 4 gram per day of N3 fatty acids to reduce triglyceride levels by 20 to 30%. Regarding other agents, as you know, the development of medication discussed above has led to decline in the use of older agents such as fibrates, niacin, and bile acid sequence traits, which were previously mainstay of the lipid management. This agent, as well as restricted use therapeutics reserved for the treatment of severe lipid disorders. In 2018, cholesterol guidelines recommend measurement of lipid levels every 4 to 12 weeks after the initiation of a statin or dose adjustment to assist patient adherence to the prescription. Also, the extent of reduction in the LDL cholesterol level. Subsequently, periodic measurement of lipids every 3 to 12 months is reasonable. Regarding the fasting lipid profile, for most patients, fasting is not required before testing, although a fasting lipid profile may still be beneficial in the evaluation of genetic hyperlipidemia or premature atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease or persistent hypertriglyceridemia. As we mentioned, the limitation of the article is new therapies for lowering lipid levels are showing promising results in early clinical trials, but are still waiting confirmation of benefit and safety in large cardiovascular outcome studies. So new therapies in this review article needs further randomized control trials with a large population. So in conclusion, for patients whose risk of cardiovascular disease is sufficiently elevated to suggest a net benefit, pharmacological treatment with statin is recommended, with the intensity of treatment matching the absolute baseline level of cardiovascular risk. For patients at high risk who have not had the anticipated reduction in LDL cholesterol level of 50% or more, or who have a residual LDL cholesterol level of 70 milligram per deciliter or higher, despite therapy with the maximum tolerated dose of statin, ezetimibe with or without a PCSK9 inhibitor may be considered for secondary prevention. Those are my references. Thank you very much for listening, and we'll receive the questions now.
Thanks, Dr. Shah, for nice talk and summaries of these articles. We leave the questions for end of this sessions. For next speaker, Dr. Walid Taimani. He's a medical degree from King Abdulaziz University. Now he's joining us as the clinical pathology resident in R2. He will present clinical cases paper, which has been published in Clinical Chemistry Journal as 54 years old diabetic man with low serum cholesterol. For bring this case in King Saud University as teaching for all the laboratory sites to how to reach diagnosis from the routine labs investigations. Okay, Dr. Walid Taiman, welcome.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Walid Fadi Taimani. I am a clinical pathology resident in King Saud University. Thank you, Dr. Khalid, and thank you, Dr. Shahr, for this wonderful presentation and introduction. So our case study today is a very, very interesting case study. It goes as follow. A 54-year-old asymptomatic man with a 5-year history of a type 2 diabetes mellitus was found to have an extremely low serum cholesterol concentration. He had no history of major childhood illness, malabsorption, or any cardiovascular or neurologic dysfunction. He had smoked for 30 years and was not using alcohol or any lipid-lowering drugs. Additionally, he was not vegetarian, and his family history included stroke, father died at the age of 50 years and chronic kidney disease, 57 years old brother. His eldest son had died of a suspected myocardial infarction at the age of 21 years. The patient had a blood pressure of 120 over 80 and a heart rate of 78 beats per minute and a body mass index of 32 kilograms per meter per square meter. The results of a physical examination were normal. Hepatic stenosis, steatosis, and the mild hepatomegaly were observed via abdominal ultrasonography. A transthoracic echocardiogram was normal, and the results of a treadmill exercise test, a Bruce protocol, were negative. So, as you can see here in Table 2, the laboratory results for serum lipids. Lipoproteins, apolipoproteins, proteins, immunoglobulins, and fat-soluble vitamins and provitamins were done. Of note, as you can see here, concentration of total cholesterol, triglyceride, LDL-C, and the apolipoprotein B were all markedly decreased. زي ما انتم شايفين, the serum concentration of total protein and globulin were both high. And also IgA is extremely high and IgM is low. These are quantification tests for immunoglobulins. The result of serologic tests for hepatitis A, B, C viruses and HIV were all negative. Other laboratory studies were performed, serum concentration of liver enzyme, results of thyroid function test, and values of hematology parameters were all normal. As were those for serum bilirubin, creatinine, urea, nitrogen, uric acid, and calcium. The fasting serum glucose concentration was increased 155 milligrams per deciliter, and hemoglobin A1C of 7% was increased. Now, what questions do we consider? First question, what are the typical lipids abnormalities seen in a person with type 2 diabetes mellitus? And why was this patient had a very, very low lipid profile? The second question, what are the possible causes of low serum cholesterol, LDL, and ApoB? Third, what further testing could be done to clarify the cause of the decreased lipid concentration in this case? And fourth, given the patient's serum total protein and globulin results, what additional testing should be performed? Our subject today is called hypobeta-lipoproteinemia. Now, hypobeta-lipoproteinemia is defined by plasma concentration of total cholesterol, LDL-C, or ApoB that are lower than the fifth percentile. Primary HBL includes a group of genetic disorders, and they entitle three or four main branches. The first one is A-beta-lipoproteinemia, also called ABL for short, Chylomicron retention disease, CMRD, and familial HBL. Now, the familial HBL, we have a homozygous and a heterozygous. So this is why I said three or four in the beginning. Now, A-beta lipoproteinemia is a condition usually diagnosed early in life. It features steatorrhea, oral fat intolerance, acanthocytosis, retinitis pigmentosa, and neurologic abnormalities. The plasma lipid profile of ABL patient is characterized by extremely low plasma total cholesterol, VLDL, and LDL concentration, and an almost complete absence of ApoB, a complete absence of ApoB. Now, chylomicron retention disease is characterized by the absence of ApoB in plasma. Steatorrhea, malnutrition, and growth retardation are the main clinical manifestation of CMRD because hepatic ApoB synthesis is maintained. LDLs are present in the plasma. FHBL or familial hypobeta lipoproteinemia is a condominant disorder with a frequency in the heterozygous form of 1 in 500 to 1 in 1,000. So this is a very, very rare disease. FHBL heterozygotes are often symptom-free, but may also present with non-alcoholic fatty liver disease and a mild increase in the serum concentration of the liver enzyme. But pay attention, it may present itself symptom-free. FHBL homozygous may experience severe fat malabsorption and show severe clinical and biochemical manifestations similar to those of ABL. Interestingly, plasma ApoB concentration are lower than expected for the deficiency of only one gene. Or, as was the case here, approximately 50% of FHBL patients are carriers of pathogenic mutations in the APO lipoprotein B gene, or APOB for short. It's not all genetic, because we can have a secondary causes of HBL. HBL can also be caused by severe non-genetic factors, such as a strict vegetarian diet, malnutrition, drugs, and disease-related conditions. These factors are regarded as a secondary causes of HBL because the liver plays a key role in the metabolism of most plasma lipoproteins and apolipoproteins. Alterations in plasma lipid patterns can be observed in conditions characterized by hepatic cellular damage. So mainly the liver, if you play with the liver, you can have abnormal lipoproteins. Also, such as infections by hepatitis B, C viruses, cirrhosis, or hepatocellular carcinoma. Moreover, increased consumption of cholesterol by tumor cells plays a role in reducing serum cholesterol in hepatocellular carcinoma. Also, advanced stages of HIV infections are characterized by reduced TC, HDLC, and LDLC concentration, and increased triglyceride concentration in the plasma. Enhanced cholesterol exertion and increased LDL turnover are believed to be the responsible for the hypocholesteremia seen in hyperthyroidism. Lastly, malnutrition and inflammation are thought to be responsible for the hypocholesterolemia observed in chronic hemodialysis patients. Now, further analysis of low LDLC and ApoB. Secondary hyperlipoproteinemia with increased VLDLC concentration and decreased HDLC concentration usually accompany type 2 diabetes mellitus. This is the first question we asked and questions to consider. This is the clinical picture of a type 2 diabetes mellitus. Increased VLDLC concentration and decreased HDLC. Although the patient had a very low lipid concentration in the serum. So we had to question the patient. When the patient was questioned further, he remembered that he had previously had low cholesterol concentration, but unfortunately there was no available data. Then we had to rule out any interference in the measurement. The reaction kinetics of the lipid parameters was analyzed that have been measured with the Roche molecular system and commercial kits. The reaction curves were normal and the patient's data met all the biochemical criteria for an HBL diagnosis. Next, in the differential diagnosis, we said before that the secondary causes of HBL were excluded first. The patient was not a vegetarian and not using any lipid-lowering drugs. Furthermore, he had no signs, symptoms, or laboratory findings of any disease that could be associated with secondary HBL. Therefore, the patient's disease was diagnosed phenotypically as primary HBL. Now, as we said before, ABL, CMRD, and homozygous FHBL are associated with a severe clinical phenotype, notably in children and young adults. The patient, however, showed no evidence of malabsorption, retinitis pigmentosa, or neurologic disease, and there was no evidence of acanthocytes. So the mild clinical phenotype strongly suggested the clinical diagnosis of heterozygous FHBL, as we said before, given that the patient's family history included a sudden death of a son at a young age and the heterozygous FHBL carriers of short tourniqueted forms might be at risk of developing more severe liver disease. Now, the last thing is we did a molecular diagnosis and was confirmed through molecular diagnosis by identifying the mutation in the APO APOB gene. But we also had an increased total serum protein. So we had to further evaluate the increased serum protein. The first thing we did in table one, it was an immunoglobulin quantification. It showed a greatly increased IgA concentration, a markedly decreased IgM concentration, and a borderline low IgG concentration. Next thing we did was serum protein electrophoresis. Serum protein electrophoresis revealed a monoclonal spike in the B region. This monoclonal band was characterized by serum immune fixation electrophoresis as an IgA kappa band. Now we did the same thing with the urine. We did the protein electrophoresis and immunofixation electrophoresis for the urine and did not reveal the presence of a monoclonal protein. If it did show a monoclonal protein in the urine, this would lead us to other malignant differential diagnoses. Now, we did a bone marrow biopsy and revealed plasma cells that are slightly increased by 5 to 6%. But it was less than 10%, and it was 5 to 6% in the bone marrow. The reference interval for normal plasma cells is 0.2% to 2.2%. The last thing we did was the radiological skeletal survey, and it revealed no osteolytic lesions because the patient showed no clinical manifestation related to the monoclonal gammopathy, such as hypercalcemia, anemia, renal insufficiency, or bone lesions. He was diagnosed with monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance, or MGUS for short. Now, quick overview and conclusion with the MGUS. MGUS is a symptomatic pre-malignant disorder that is identified through routine blood tests, usually in people above 50 years of age. MGUS is defined by a serum monoclonal protein concentration of less than 3 gram per deciliter and by plasma cells less than 10% in the bone marrow without any evidence of multiple myeloma or other related malignant disorder. Another quick notion is that MGUS is actually a pre-malignant disorder that precedes a condition called multiple myeloma. This is why we are saying that plasma cells has to be less than 10% and there is no malignant related malignant disorder, whether it's anemia or nephropathy, because if it was otherwise, then we would suspect multiple myeloma. Now, we finished our case study, and this is a point to remember. HBL is defined by plasma TC, LDLC, or ApoB concentrations that are lower than the fifth percentile. HBL may be caused by mutations in several genes, primary HBL, and by several non-genetic factors, such as a strict vegetarian diet, malnutrition, drugs, and disease-related conditions, also called secondary HBL. If HBL is an autosomal dominant disorder that may be caused by mutations in the gene encoding ApoB that leads to the formation of tourniquet ApoB species. If HBL heterozygous are often symptom-free, like our patient, but may also present with non-alcoholic fatty liver disease and a mild increase in a serum concentration of liver enzymes. The presence of FHBL can be protective against the progression of atherosclerosis, and this is very interesting because it's being studied now as a means to prevent atherosclerotic disease. MGUS is a symptomatic pre-malignant disorder defined by a serum monoclonal protein concentration of less than 3 grams per deciliter, and by plasma cells that are less than 10% in the bone marrow without evidence of multiple myeloma or other related malignant disorder. This is our reference. I hope you all enjoyed, and thank you so much.
Thanks, Dr. Walid, for nice talk and the presentation you have been done. Actually, I have it in my chat related questions to journal clubs or the case presentation. Most of the questions regarding how to the register of the Saudi counseling get the CMEs. I think after they finish this talk, you receive the survey. If you complete the survey, you will, I think, automated get your CME in your Momaris Plus. One of the consultants, he has two comments, but I don't know how to make the his comments regarding this paper, Dr. Zahir Shehri. Most of them, no more questions. I would thanks all the attendees for our talks. I hope you enjoy and get the information regarding our case and our journal club in your future. One comment, Dr. Walid, regarding the case you have been present. I think you should think about, in this case, interference for the method with the high IgA kappa, the MGUS. Maybe the high total protein maybe interference with the method measurement for the lipid profile.
Yes.
Any comments from the speakers? They have question for Dr. Shar. Should be fasting or not fasting lipid profile?
For the lipid profile, Dr. Khaled, the last update of this general article review, they said, just to mention it here, Doctor, for the addition here, for a patient, it should be fasting in most cases, but it's not required before the testing. Yani, the fasting lipid profile may be still yani, beneficial, or the evaluation of genetic hyperlipidemia can be done without fasting. Tamam? Hello, Doctor, Smani?
Thanks.
معي دكتور معي؟
معك تمام.
معي دكتور؟
أيوه أسمعك.
سمعت.
سمعت الجواب أوكي. Okay. Thanks.
Fasting is not required before the testing.
Okay, great.
But unfortunately, most hospitals request the patient to be fasted. But this article, يعني give us a new advice that it's not required. Which is, yani, make it easier for the patient.
With thanks all the attendees for their being with us for this lectures and the journal club. I think no more questions in the chat. Most of the questions regarding the how to register in the CMA. Also, they already the answer the question regarding the fasting or not fasting the lipid profile. One more questions, but I don't know the answer. Does the olive oil elevate the lipid?
Ciao, ciao.
Hello, Dr. Shahab.
Hello, Dr. Khalid. Naam.
They have questions from one of the guys. He said, does the olive oil affect the lipid measurement?
Olive oil?
Yes.
Actually, I have no idea, doctor. But maybe I'll research for it and I'll send it to you.
Okay, if me, I don't know.
Okay. Me too, I don't know.
I will conclude that I will thank Dr. Walid Taimani and Dr. Shara Al-Ahmari and Saudi Society for Clinical Chemistry for giving us the chance to present this journal club from the King Saud University Hospital and King Saud University Medical City. Thanks all to being with us and have a good night to you.